Before we go to our second panel, which is going to explore proposals for regulation and oversight of social media, we want to take a look at film and how film is handling the tension between the social media platforms and democracy. We're going to hear a conversation between Larissa Rhodes, who is producer of The Social Dilemma, and Katharina Gellein, who is director of People You May Know, a film from Metrotone Media. But before we hear from them, we are going to have a chance to take a look at their films.
When you go to Google and type in climate change is, you're going to see different results depending on where you live and the particular things that Google knows about your interests.
That's not by accident, that's a design technique.
What I want people to know is that everything they're doing online is being watched, is being tracked. Every single action you take is carefully monitored and recorded.
A lot of people think Google's just a search box and Facebook's just a place to see what my friends are doing. What they don't realize is there's entire teams of engineers whose job is to use your psychology against you.
I was the co-inventor of the Facebook like button.
I was the president of Pinterest.
Google.
Twitter.
Instagram.
There were meaningful changes happening around the world because of these platforms.
I think we were naive about the flip side of that coin.
We get rewarded by hearts, likes, thumbs up. And we conflate that with value, and we conflate it with truth.
A whole generation is more anxious, more depressed.
I always felt like fundamentally it was a force for good. I don't know if I feel that way anymore.
Facebook discovered that they were able to affect real-world behavior and emotions without ever triggering the user's awareness. They are completely clueless.
Fake news spreads 6 times faster than true news.
We're being bombarded with rumors.
If everyone's entitled to their own facts, there's really no need for people to come together. In fact, there's really no need for people to interact.
We have less control over who we are and what we really believe.
If you want to control the population of your country, there has never been a tool as effective as Facebook.
We built these things and we have a responsibility to change it. The intention could be, how do we make the world better?
If technology creates mass chaos, loneliness, more polarization, more election hacking, more inability to focus on the real issues, we're toast.
This is checkmate on humanity.
Do people in churches know their personal information is being gathered to use in political campaigns?
No.
The meetings are secret. The membership is secret. Kellyanne Conway is a member. Steve Bannon is a member. They hope to use Trump as God's wrecking ball.
I had used and worked with predictive analytics and big data tools. What would it look like to use it within the realm of ministry? There's no better product than the gospel.
I've read an article that you said you'd worked with the original data guys, Cambridge Analytica.
We worked with...
I was sure that there must be something that would lead us to being able to nail Cambridge Analytica.
There's a reason that not many people have come forward and spoken about Cambridge Analytica.
I'm in Paddington Station, and I've got this hard drive on me, and I'm just terrified.
It helps us track people. It helps us to keep track of all the kids that are here.
All of a sudden, you have this ability to enumerate things about Beth, or you can draw it out.
They began isolating me away from my family.
With one person, it's like, you know, one single grain of gunpowder.
And then we have here taking the state for Christ together.
But when you've got a huge pile of it, you don't want to match to get anywhere near it because it'll kill you.
you can add the family dynamic of propensity for divorce.
They're targeting extraordinarily vulnerable individuals.
Opioid dependence, different mental health disorders.
States decide to rewrite the U.S. Constitution.
The ultimate position to be in is when your adversary has no idea that they're in a war.
My secret recorders are these.
Pass security, pass the Secret Service.
Vice President.
I bring greetings from President Donald Trump.
There's two ways to rewrite the U.S. Constitution. You can handle marriage equality. You can handle issues of women's rights, term limits.
The American government is slated for destruction.
We own the relationship space. Like, we own it. That's the church.
Hey, Larissa.
Oh, good to see you.
I'm so glad to have this opportunity to chat. And hey to everybody else. Happy to be here with you.
Yes, thank you all for having us. We're very honored to be here today.
I wanted to ask you something, Larissa, as my first question to you. This is a hard topic to draw people in on. Social media, we all know it's bad for you, but it doesn't seem to penetrate most people's consciousness enough to make them put down the phone or actually do anything about it. So I was really interested in how you used this fiction tool in a documentary to draw the audience in. Could you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, well, thank you so much. I think for us, it was really a journey in and of ourselves. Jeff, the director of the film, had grown up using technology, went to Stanford. A number of his buddies ended up, working at many of these tech companies. And both my parents were computer scientists and engineers. So we're not anti-tech. I think we were very much pro-tech. And it wasn't until Tristan actually, brought this story to light, and many of the other organizations and activists in the space have been, calling out and talking about how, yes, there are good pieces of technology, and also there are negative aspects of these social media and search platforms. And I think for us, it was really trying to figure out how do we reveal what's on the other side of the phone. And that was this narrative component. What's on the other side of our screen, and how can we show that through whether that's graphics or animation or through these narrative elements to be able to reveal the algorithms, the manipulation that's happening on the other side of the screen. I was curious for you, because I think, you also were sort of revealing what's on the other side of our screen. In this case, whistleblowers and experts speaking about some of these issues in a more focused way. And I was curious if you wanted to talk about just algorithmic surveillance and predictive, technology that's micro-targeting our nation.
Well, so, I mean, we came to it from the perspective of Charles working for the British committee, who first went into this field of holding social media companies to account. And so he was really the tech expert. I was just a filmmaker when we started doing it. And I learned a lot. I started from the point of, isn't Google just an innocent thing that I use, and I have nothing to hide, so why should I worry about it? All the way through to now knowing too much about radicalization on social media. So that's been my focus almost, the worrying parts of radicalization through these tools. So of course we know that these algorithms can pose problems, as you pointed out in your film. But what I think we really need to worry about now is vulnerable groups being radicalized. And we start raising that in people you may know, where you have somebody who's perhaps grieving or have gone through addiction or things like that. and how they can be targeted and then radicalized online. And this is really serious. I mean, we saw the effect of it in January 6th, the insurrection on the Capitol. And as it turns out, about 20% of those people were veterans. And veterans who had struggled with addiction, among other things. So trauma and addiction is a real factor when it comes to algorithmic targeting online.
And I, you know, it's so interesting. One of the subjects in our film, Tim Kendall, who sort of helped build the business model, he was head of monetization at Facebook and then ended up being CEO at Pinterest later on. But in the film, we ask him, you know, what are you most concerned about? And he says, in the short term, civil war. And when we first released the film, you know, there were questions of whether or not that was a little bit too far-fetched. Is that, you know, a little exaggerated? And I think, unfortunately, the events of January 6th, you know, show that online harm can become real world offline harm. And that concept of radicalization, I think, is scary because, you know, this is a democracy summit and we're looking at the technology being used in a way that can really be up for grabs for whoever has, you know, the ability, the money, the thought to be able to target and hyper target, you know, the population for their benefit, for their good.
Charles in our film, you know, you used to be able to. Now you can shout in somebody's ear directly and you can micro-target to scale. And that's just that kind of thing has never really been done. And I think even though most people hear about it, I don't think its real world offline effect, as you say, really hits home. Do you feel like the social dilemma had the desired effect you guys wanted it to have?
You know, I think definitely we've been seeing an increase in awareness around these issues. And I think policymakers are waking up to the various elements of, you know, it's a big issue. And it's we call it a foundational issue. It is underlying so many of the other issues, recognizing that we don't have a public square anymore. We have individualized, personalized filter bubbles that are radicalizing people towards, you know, what is most profitable for these companies. So I think for us, we are starting to see that you know, the general public as well as regulators are waking up to these issues, and not just waking up to them, but truly understanding what's behind the curtain. And at the same time, recognizing that these are so complicated and they're also intertwined that I think it's very difficult to point to, you know, this is the one, there's no silver bullet. It is just like climate change in the existential nature of this issue. I'm curious if you've seen the effects and solutions that you're hoping to see coming out of your film coming out.
Well, ours was interesting because, you know, it was very partisan, as you would call it. It was I was a great admirer of how you guys managed to make your film bipartisan. But because ours was, it was very targeted towards specific things. And, you know, I again, like you, I would say the awareness is there now much more than before. But I think there are still operatives operating much like before, and until you change the model and the underlying business model, it's very hard to change these problems because it has such ripple effects throughout. But particularly in terms of election and changing laws, I think it's quite dire now that we have to do it. And then you run into other troubles such as censorship. And of course, what we hear from the channels of radicalization right now is they're being censored. As things are being taken down, as false content's being taken down, they cry censorship. And then you have, there is a real issue there, particularly in America with the First Amendment. You know, if Facebook can censor Donald Trump Twitter can censor Donald Trump, well, then don't they also have a responsibility for what goes out on their platform if they are able to censor? So it's complex, as you say.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's really big questions being asked about who are the arbiters of truth, and what is our information ecosystem, and who gets to dictate that? You know, it used to be that we would go to the library or we'd have a certain number of channels that were regulated on TV, and we were able to decide, you know, what the rules were. We weren't going to target, you know, certain ads and products to children on Saturday morning during cartoons. All of those regulations have gone out the window with regards to YouTube for Kids or our search functions. So I think for, you know, the policymakers out there, it's really for us, it is very parallel to climate change and an extractive industry, and recognizing that these products are not being built with humanity's best interests at heart. They are being designed to basically, keep us scrolling, keep us clicking, and that is not, that extractive business model is going to make them money. But what are the consequences to our society? So I think you're absolutely right.
Yeah, it's very challenging. We're making a new film right now, in the same vein, and it's going into disinformation specifically. And what we're seeing right now is extreme radicalization, especially in Europe as well, but across America. And you're saying these pockets, of course, now during the pandemic, it's much worse. We're all more online than we ever were before. And you talked about who are the arbiters of truth. And I think the problem is trust here. Who do we trust? And do we place trust in institutions? And this was in people you may know, we had the church, and people trust the church incredibly in the States particularly. And what happens if the institutions you trust are not trustworthy? So now, of course, we see vast spread distrust in government, in pharmaceutical companies, and some of it naturally so. But then you also get widespread distrust in a cure, like a vaccine. So who do we trust, and how do we regain that trust? I spoke to an expert at the University of Maryland the other day who said, you almost have to treat these radicalized groups like QAnon, for example, like a cult, like when you try to extract someone from a cult. But they're even finding that that doesn't work right now because of how strong these social media bubbles are. Right now I'm on some Telegram channels to do with research for the film, and you have moms there, for example, who say, oh, well, my child doesn't believe like I do that vaccines are bogus or whatever it is. But then this person gets validation from 60, 70, 80 other people in the channel who say, no, you're right. Your version of truth is okay. And that's where we have these radicalization bubbles again, and how do you break someone out of feeling validated, feeling right? That's really, really hard.
Well, and I think it's especially hard because that's not the way these platforms were designed. These platforms were, again, designed by a business model that is meant to, we are not the product, and we're not paying for the product. That means we are the product in this case. And I think recognizing that as we look at how these systems are set up, they are designed to keep us clicking because that is the best thing for their business model. And as you were mentioning, the information ecosystem is being able to be targeted, whether that's by misinformation, disinformation. There's a number of different things. Some of them are mistakes. Some of them are actually, in a sense, terrorism. When you look at the anti-vax movement here in the U.S., and it is one of the biggest biosecurity threats we face as a nation. Imran Ahed from Stop Hate for Profit, recently spoke to that, and thinking about the fact that any individual, good intent or bad intent, can use these technologies to spread information. And as you said, it is about trusted messengers. So I think it's going to be a challenge for us to try to figure out how do we regulate that, especially with free speech in our nation. I'm not wanting to quell that or quash that. But I guess, a question to you when it comes to sort of your film and the way that you were looking at radicalization and, vulnerable populations. Do you feel that, we are able to get off of these extractive models, or how do you see, the way out?
Well, this is the question for everyone right now, isn't it? And the question that I frequently ask others as well. I think, community and listening is really important. And that's why institutions like the church, which we featured in People You May Know, can be really helpful. If it can actually help people come back out of it. And if we can come offline and come together in communities more than we have in the past. But listening, right now with the film that I'm making, I really want to try and hear all sides of the story. I want to hear the people who have been radicalized and why they believe the way they do, because it's very easy to dismiss everyone as, well, that person's an idiot, or that person is uneducated, and the truth is we're all vulnerable. And as we saw with People You May Know, all it takes is for you to have a weak moment in your life. Something happened to your child, something happened to your parent, something happened in your at your workplace to make you vulnerable, and that's an in for something or somebody to radicalize you, so that somebody can open up and listen and go, okay, I hear how that happened and how that was terrible, and then try and work outwards from there. I think that it's a really key thing to that people feel heard, because if we just divide and we go, well, you're an idiot and I'm right, we're never gonna bridge it, even though it's very, you know, it can be very tempting with things that I think is obvious or you think is obvious. What about you guys? Did you find any paths out?
Yeah, I mean, it's a really complicated issue, and I think recognizing again the foundational nature of it, I think that's what helps people get on board, because the reality is, like, this affects everyone, whether you're on social media or not, whether you use Google as a search engine or not. These you know, platforms are so ingrained into our society globally, that it's going to be very difficult for us to get off of them. And so I think what needs to happen is that the companies themselves need to shift. They need to recognize that, yes, there are good things that come out of these, you know, technologies. It is wonderful that you can quickly Google something, but I think the question is, you know, what's behind the Google? What ads am I being served, and where is the placement, and how is that, you know, what biases are driving those algorithms and that predictive technology? So I think it's about asking those questions and figuring out, you know, who is this really serving? Is this really serving our population, me as an individual, or is this serving the advertisers and the business model on these platforms? And how do we realign those technologies for the public good?
Yeah, to come back and not to feature the negative again, but what I can see in these channels is that they do see that there is a problem with profit and for-profit models, but that is exactly the thing that drives their misinformed perspective as well. They're going, well, you know, I don't trust Bill Gates or the pharmaceutical companies, or I don't trust these things. So they can see that, and very often there's grains of truth in there. There's little bits of, you know, facts that you've drawn or really genuine skepticism that's healthy, but then you spin your own agenda from it. So we also have to all learn to, you know, take a breath and think that, you know, what if I'm wrong? What if I have to inform myself better? And there are people who've done that, who've come back. So, you know, it is possible to de-radicalize, but goodness, it's a challenge.
Well, it's a challenge, especially because I don't think, you know, we think we're invulnerable. And I think that's something that I learned from the making of the film. You know, we use the concept of magic, and, you know, thinking about how we're all susceptible to magic. And I think that for me was such a visual representation of how I envision, you know, my environment online, my social media, my, you know, search platforms. I'm no longer on social media, but when I was, you know, I was getting information pushed to me that I assumed was correct. And you know, all of my friends, my family, the news that I was getting from those platforms. So I think it is questioning and really digging further, fact checking and making sure that your sources are good sources, and that nobody is invulnerable to these technologies.
So if you come off social media, Larissa, how has that been? How's that process been? And can you manage to keep that up? I want to hear about that.
Yes, we can offline about it. For me, it has been wonderful, but recognize it's not for everyone at this point, given COVID and everything. But I think it is questioning, you know, what are these platforms really offering to us? And can we get that somewhere else in an offline or in through a service or a product that isn't, you know, a third party manipulating us to their benefit and to their profit? So I'm excited about your new film, and it's been just really, really wonderful to learn a little bit more and see how all of these issues are intermingling and crossing over.
Absolutely. And back over to you guys. Back over to Jane.
Okay, Larissa and Katharine, thank you both. And if you haven't seen those films, The Social Dilemma and People You May Know, I have seen them both, and I recommend them to you.